At the Magical Bridge Playground, our On the Move crew met Emily McQueen. Emily helped with the wheelchair access designs of the playground since she is a marathon wheelchair racer, as well as the mother of active boys. We learned that she injured her back when she was a freshman at Ricks College, and after rehabilitation, she finished college maneuvering her wheelchair through sleet and snow. Her story includes a wonderful husband, and Emily is currently very busy raising her boys and keeping fit with her wheelchair racing. Our On the Move host, Donna Yeager, talks with Emily McQueen to hear about her latest accomplishments. Now, here's Donna.
Hi, I'm Donna Yeager with On the Move. I'd like to welcome our very special guest, Emily McQueen. Welcome, Emily.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
Thank you. And I know that you have been very involved with the Magic Bridge Playground, right?
Yes. Yeah.
What's your official title there?
So I'm one of the board members of the Friends of the Magical Bridge.
Okay.
And so I helped to do some consulting about how parents in wheelchairs specifically can navigate playgrounds with their children, keeping them safe and having fun with them at the same time.
All right. And you read about it and thought it was a really interesting program to get involved with.
I did. I'm not from Palo Alto. I live down in San Jose, and I was reading one of the Bay Area magazines, which featured the plans for the park, and I thought, I'm reading this article at the perfect time, because I really wanted to be part of the project, and it was just kind of in the planning mode at that point.
Yeah.
And so I got in right at the perfect time, and was able to meet with the architects and kind of in the board setting as we were kind of just nailing down exactly what design would be good for parents and children with disabilities.
Well, it's a wonderful place because I've been there about 4 or 5 times now, and it's just, it is very magical. It's a lot of fun, and it's for adults too, but the kids love to play in all the different areas of the park. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it is.
And we've met so many wonderful people there. Boy, it's been really great.
It is. Center of a good community.
Yeah. A lot of really good people and worked very hard to get it, you know, up and running. And
Yeah.
Really neat. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about your childhood.
So I grew up in Portland, Oregon, and I'm the 4th of 5 kids. And I grew up just kind of being a silly kid, climbing trees, being nutty, and I was always really interested in art, and those themes kind of continued throughout my life.
Right, very good. And then you were going to college, right?
Mm-hmm, yeah. I started college in 1999 at Ricks College. It's now BYU-Idaho.
Okay.
And I fell in love with college. Yeah. I was like, so happy being there.
It was,
I felt like I had arrived.
You know what? This is where my parents met each other.
Oh, yeah.
It's a small world, huh?
That is.
Really? Wow.
Really? That's good to know.
That's great. Yeah. So, but you really enjoyed it, right?
I did. Yeah. I felt like I had just come into my element, and I loved classes and all of the activity of college.
Yeah. Great. Yeah. And so tell us a little bit, just quickly, over what did happen there? Did it accident?
Oh, yeah. So about 2 months into my first semester, I had honestly just finished my midterms, and I was having, I was on a date. We had just gone like swing dancing, and I was very much into like the social dance part of the college. And and then we were like, let's just go climb a tree, and which is, had been somewhat of a habit over the last couple weeks, was to climb trees every night, because of course any college campus has phenomenal climbing trees.
Oh.
And so I was climbing, and I was like, let me just go to the top of the tree and see how high I can go in this one.
Oh.
So I did, and I had climbed thousands of things in my life, and I had never fallen once. So I was climbing confidently, and I started to descend, and I just felt myself slipping and falling, and I was really surprised, honestly. I think I had one of those experiences where time slowed down on my fall down, and I was thinking many thoughts, like, this feels weird. I've never fallen before. Uh-oh, when am I going to hit the ground? And all these like really long thoughts were happening in this short amount of time.
And then
I did. I actually hit a branch on the way down that severed my spine. And then I actually broke the branch, and then I landed on it on the ground.
Ow.
Yeah, ouch. It was from about 30 feet. And so, but I think the branch did me a favor, as in it slowed my speed.
Oh yeah.
And so I wasn't hitting the ground, and my head and my brain didn't receive the full impact of the 30 feet, I think, because I was slowed down a bit.
Wow.
Yeah,
so. So it actually saved your life by slowing you down a little.
That's my guess. I don't have like a professional assessment on it, but I think that it's, I think it did me a favor because I was conscious through the whole thing. Which is kind of phenomenal for falling that far. I remember every bit of it.
I
had some unique impressions and a spiritual experience right there in it all, very much.
And your brain is so important, so that's good that it's
still
intact.
Here. Almost, right? After having five babies, it's like little bits of it drift away in the pregnancies. But brain's still here. It's good.
That's right. And speaking of, we'll talk about your children in a minute, but how did you meet Chris?
Chris, my husband, and I, we met at, we were camp counselors in 2002, and we were each over these large groups of kids. So a camp counselor we had like 16 kids each, and I had 16 teenage girls, and he had 16 teenage boys, and they just happened to put our two groups in the same dorm for their sleeping arrangements. And I had my girls positioned on both the upper level and the lower level with no elevator. And so I was somewhat a little bit cautious of keeping my girls safe and really keeping them away from his boys. And so we staked out the stairwell at night just to make sure there was no like interfloor transferring and that everyone stayed in their own rooms. And that's actually where we met and hit it off, that stairwell.
Cool. So it was kind of a quiet place to visit.
It was. It was good. And we felt like little like spies staying up the wee hours of the morning watching for teenagers.
That's great.
Yeah, it was a good place to meet.
Oh, that's wonderful. I know. And then, so how long was it until you got married?
Yeah, so we dated, we met in the summer and then we got married the next May. So it was really the whole thing. I mean, I fell in love with him first.
Yeah.
I was definitely the aggressive one, and now I wanted I wanted him, let's just say that. And so I kind of caused things to progress a little bit. I added another session of being a camp counselor where I knew he was going to be. And so, things happen a little faster than I would say normally.
That's great.
I just knew we were right for each other.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
And so where was the wedding?
Yeah, we got married in Portland, Oregon.
Okay, good.
It was really beautiful.
With the family.
Yeah, right, everyone was around.
And where's his family from?
So Chris grew up in Orem, Utah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, okay. So it was good. Yeah, he was there, and we actually were living in different cities for most of our courtship, and we would do a lot of driving in between our two colleges. We were both kind of on scholarship in our own areas, so we didn't want to leave those.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, he's a good man, and we have lots of fun together.
Oh, that's wonderful. And I know that, you know, being married is a wonderful feeling. It's so good to, you know that somebody's got your back and they're right there with you.
He does.
It's true. It's so wonderful.
Yes.
Yeah, that's great. Well, it's good that you have such a marvelous partner. That's great.
Yeah, he's a good man.
Partner in crime.
Exactly.
No, that's not the right answer. Didn't mean it that way.
No, it is. It's good.
And so your first son was born, right?
So our oldest son is named Alex.
Yeah.
And so I have, our oldest is a 10-year-old, and then we have Aaron, our 9-year-old, and we have a 5-year-old named Jacob. And we have a son named Andrew, who was born with a diaphragmatic hernia.
Oh, wow.
So he passed away when he was 9 months. And so he's our fourth. And he will always be with us, even though he's not here in our home with us. We feel his spirit.
It's a beautiful photo that you have of the whole family.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. It's and then just younger than him is our latest little addition is Jonas.
Aww.
And he is 8 months and is like Well, he's like my favorite child.
Yeah, he's adorable.
He's a cutie.
It's a great thing. I'm sure he keeps you busy. Well, I'm sure they all keep you busy.
Oh, Jonah started crawling this couple of weeks, and so he is crawling all over the house. I just hear his thud, thud, thud of his hands and knees, and it's so sweet.
That's adorable. That's cool. Yeah. And you said they just started school, too, right?
They did. They they kind of go in full force. So they, the sixth grader and the fourth grader and my little five-year-old just started transitional kindergarten.
Wow.
So he's a big man now.
Ooh.
Yeah, all these school-going boys.
Oh, my goodness. A little empty nest in the middle of the day, right?
Yeah, I don't mind an empty nest at all. I love to stretch out of my nest, take a nap. Who am I talking? Who am I fooling? I do laundry during the day.
You're a busy girl.
Keep up with all their dirty, stinky clothes.
And I'm sure there's a lot of it.
Exactly.
I mean, they're busy playing.
Yes, yeah. Several outfits every day from every one of them.
And I know that you've been really involved with the racing, right?
Yeah.
A wheelchair racing, right?
Yeah, so wheelchair racing is a sport that was developed and kind of really made a big increase in the 80s.
Yeah.
And at any kind of mainstream road race that like normal runners would attend, like the Boston Marathon, for example, they have a division that is for wheelchair racers. And because wheelchair racing is the wheelchair equivalent to running, and then hand cycling is like the wheelchair equivalent to cycling, road cycling.
Right.
And so they look somewhat similar. They both, a racing wheelchair has like three large wheels, two back wheels, and then a smaller front wheel, and it's about 6 feet long. And these racing chairs are just designed to go so fast.
Wow.
And they're just kind of an amazing vehicle.
Yeah.
Some of my most memorable times have been on this marathon course in southern Utah called the St. George Marathon. And it's actually rated as a pretty amazing marathon to see, because you start in the dark up in a canyon, and it's like 5:30 in the morning, so it's totally dark.
Wow.
And you're headed down this road, and the hills are so steep and long, and they go stoop down, then up, and then down, because you're climbing mountains over these 26 miles. And I just remember being like in the dark, and I look at my speedometer, and I'm going like 35 miles an hour, and I'm thinking, I really hope I don't die on this course. And then the sun comes up, and it's beautiful. So basically, wheelchair racing for me has brought a whole new life and perspective, and the fitness is something that I really, really treasure. I feel like when I have that fitness, that I can have the longevity that I need to stay active with my boys. The wheelchair racing, though, when I first was injured, I pushed it away. I didn't want I didn't want to be in a wheelchair sport. I didn't want to be anything like a wheelchair in the title. Yeah. But after about 10 years when I became normal and I slipped off my pride, I really embraced the wheelchair racing. It was a great opportunity.
Well, and it gives you exercise and helps with your strength in your arms and your shoulders.
And your back and your core and honestly your brain. And all these systems are really impacted.
It's important. It really is. And it helps you really to give you a little bit of time with yourself to kind of think, clearly.
Yes. That is one thing that stay-at-home mothers don't get a lot of, is just your own time. Yeah. And no, your own time doesn't have to be like watching soap operas and eating bonbons. Like, your own time, it can be work, and it can be that focus. And I think the wheelchair racing really provides that.
Well, and you did the Boston Marathon.
Yeah.
So you have a picture that you showed us of the finish line, right?
Yeah, crossing the finish line of the Boston Marathon was a treasured memory.
Yeah.
And almost like brought tears to my eyes actually doing it, because I thought it was kind of like an impossible thing.
Uh-huh.
And so when finishing it, and historically the 2011 Boston Marathon was one of the fastest marathon Boston's in history, because the man who won it, the runner who won it, it's the fastest Boston time ever because the conditions were so good. And I felt like when I crossed the finish line, I was like, this is the best marathon I've ever done. It's so great to do it in this amazing place.
Yeah, my goodness.
It was really a good experience. It was a good example of pushing out of my comfort zone, and then the reward from it was wonderful.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, my gosh.
That's really great.
That's exciting. Oh, man.
I hope to do it again someday. And I say that with a puzzled face because it's going to be quite a climb to get back into shape like that. Because, I mean, after having babies, things fall out of shape. I hope that it's on the radar for the next couple of years.
Right. Oh, good. That's cool. Yeah. That's very good. Well, you'll make it happen, I'm sure.
I hope. Fingers. If my shoulders can stay with me, you know.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. Yeah. And you participated in an activity called, I forget what you call it, Markspace or Make. No, Maker.
Oh, yeah.
Makerspace. Right.
Yeah. So a makerspace is kind of my new interest. And a makerspace culture, it's kind of an emerging educational philosophy where if you give kids or adults, in fact, the space and the tools and the resources to make things from scratch based on a problem or a challenge, they can challenge their creativity in ways that they haven't been able to up to that point. So I find it fascinating to introduce maker spaces to children.
Yeah.
My own, of course, we kind of have a maker culture in our family, but also in schools where I volunteer and also the picture that I have is actually of a booth that we set up at the Los Gatos Art Festival that was just inviting all children who were just walking by to come and accomplish one of our two challenges.
Wow.
And our challenges were funny because they were, we challenge you to either build a house for a mouse or to launch a marshmallow 20 feet.
Ah.
And so they had to take these raw resources that we had, like wood and plastic and metal and like fabric and
rubber
all
bands.
Rubber bands, exactly. They were there. Yeah. And either accomplish one of those two challenges.
Yeah.
And it's just one of my favorite things to do because I love to see children go to new places in their creativity and accomplish that.
Well, that's great. Yeah. And you can almost see their little minds thinking, you know.
You can see it because it has this look on their face like, what am I going to do? When they go to what they think is, you know, they go as far as they can and they hit a wall and they're like, how can I get over this challenge? And that process is really reflective of what we go through every day, no matter what our age.
Right.
Is we go as far as we can, hit a challenge, and then have to navigate over and find a way.
Right. See that little light bulb light up.
Yeah, as we have to face that and have to be inventive.
Yeah.
And I think that's just, I think it's a neat process. So I really love to see that
when
kids go through that process.
Yeah, definitely. And then you do a lot of public speaking as well, right?
You know, this may surprise you, but I don't enjoy public speaking. But when I do have a message I want to convey and I am invited to do it in a public way, it is a great opportunity.
And you're very good at it.
Oh, thank you. Well, it's definitely, I have things that I want to share. And you have to open your mouth to share.
Right. So what did the P2B stand for?
Yeah, in the picture, there's a big P2B behind me. And it stands for Power to Become. The talk that I gave at BYU-Idaho campus was a part of an alumni-sponsored conference to help the students that were already enrolled in the college be able to see 10, 20 years down the road and see alumni who were doing things with their life that could show kind of what you can become and what you can become can look like a lot of different things.
Yeah.
There was a variety of speakers at the conference. And so Power to Become was really that... that kind of hoping to inspire a new upcoming generation to just really, you don't have to become a millionaire or like a star athlete or, you know, like become what that thing is that you should be.
Right. Or think out of the box, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And don't necessarily to go with what culture or the TV tells you to be when you grow up. It's like, You just follow that mm-hmm. What's inside you telling you.
Right, right. Follow your heart. Mm-hmm. Right?
Exactly. Yeah,
that's great. Yeah. Fantastic. Well, and I know that when I first met you, it was wonderful to see you are perfect of being on the move. Oh. Because you met me and you do a really beautiful job of transferring. It's an SUV that you have, right?
Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, it's a Honda Odyssey, yeah. Which is a great family van.
But it's high up off the ground.
Well, that's the funny thing is when we had our fourth child, we didn't know how to transport everyone and my chair. Yeah. And so imagine this. We have a Subaru with the three seats in the back. We had all three kids. And then we had another child. So we're like, we got to get a van. But then if you get a van with a ramp, yeah. It eliminates two of the seats. So you still only have three seats in the back.
Oh, no.
So we felt really constrained by that.
Yeah.
And so we couldn't necessarily just go forward with the ramp van.
Yeah.
And so I had to just be able to transfer and then keep all the seats as is.
Wow.
But thanks to my sweet 10-year-old son who was born as a born helper.
Yeah.
He takes my chair now and he's old enough to put it in the back and it's such a, I love it.
Well, and it's a lightweight little chair too.
Yeah, no, it is, exactly. But he's a pretty strong kid. He definitely takes off the wheels and puts it in the back.
Wow.
Yeah, so I think these boys are definitely being brought up in a non-traditional family, right?
Yeah. But he wasn't with you when I met you.
No,
so
right.
That's hard.
Yeah, I usually take the chair apart and put the wheels in and then bought the other chair in the passenger seat.
Yeah, but it looked really difficult to manipulate it from the back seat through in between your seat and...
You know,
and then up and over.
It is. It's like a little circus every time I get in and out of the car. And it used to take about 20 minutes, but now it takes about 20 seconds.
You're so fast.
It
You're
would
really
just
fast.
Be, I think it's just the practice, right?
you got used to it.
Yes, exactly. Muscle memory and everything performs
You have
better.
It down to a really good routine. Wow.
Yeah.
Amazing.
After 16 years of being in a chair.
Yeah.
Wow. My practice.
And I know that you're very proud of something that's on YouTube, so tell us about that.
Yeah, so one thing about the physical fitness aspect of my life is that after my fifth baby, I was really having, this is my most recent kind of thing that I'm exploring. Yeah. I was having a really hard time getting back into my racing chair.
Right, right.
It was too big of a leap to go from being, just postpartum and having a small baby and being like 10 pounds, 20 pounds overweight and getting back into racing was too big of a jump.
Yeah.
I really felt like it was straining my shoulders.
Oh, wow.
And that was really hard to accept and be like, well, how do I become, have an interim fitness plan that could like bridge the gap to when to allow me to be ready to race again.
Right, right.
So I had a friend who approached me. His name is Dennis Dunphy. Yeah. And he said that there is a new emerging, what is it? It's a fitness program called Stick Mobility.
Wow.
And the stick is really actually just kind of a 4-foot pipe with end caps on it. And you position the stick in different areas and you press and you put resistance on it in different ways to activate the fascial system in your body.
God.
And that really is the connective tissue that's in between the skin and the muscles. And what happens then is that you can support the shoulders and all the joints and really build your core and do it in a way that's so low impact.
Oh,
we're talking about just pressing and then activating the muscles that really don't get woken up unless we wake them up. So I'm really, really excited about stick mobility because it's my ramp that gets me right into racing.
Good.
And it'll allow me to keep my shoulders healthy and my elbows and my wrists and all these joints that are at risk.
Oh my God. Yeah. And so you can do it kind of gradually, right?
Yeah. Very gradual.
Yeah.
Yeah, I am in the long game for my physical health. So I will go just a little bit at a time and I'm feeling really good about it.
Oh, yeah, cool.
It's helping.
Cool. And you showed us that one beautiful piece of, the photo that you gave us with the painting, the stairs, right?
Yeah. So painting's always been an interest of mine. I've always loved to do art. Mm-hmm. Actually, when I was pregnant with my fourth son, we knew he had a diaphragmatic hernia when I was pregnant.
Right, right.
They told us that he probably wasn't going to survive even the first couple minutes of life.
Wow.
And receiving that diagnosis when pregnant is, it's,
hard, very hard.
Yeah, it's like shattering. Like knowing that you're going through with a pregnant, you're going continuing on a pregnancy that may have a really, a really sad ending.
Right, right.
And but may is the key word there because I didn't know. I mean, not for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
So when I was pregnant with him, I had a lot of time to really think about really my commitment to bringing little spirits into the world.
Yeah,
and I thought a lot about the more spiritual aspect of life.
Right.
And I ended up painting this stairway. It's an image of a stairway going up to a greater light that's just kind of out of reach. And that is, I entitled it The Well-Worn Ground Floor.
Oh, okay.
And that being that there is like light in our life that we can access.
Right, right.
So many times we live below our means and we kind of just go day to day and are.
Wow.
And I really felt that bringing, being pregnant with him and having kind of that
the symbolism is amazing. Yeah.
Just being really close to that light that I felt really drawn to that.
So,
I do. I love painting and I've actually gotten more into watercolor as of
beautiful.
Late.
Wow. That's great.
Thank you.
And that's fun. And you're very, very, well, actually I want you to tell me your information about how people can find out more on the YouTube.
So all you do is you go into YouTube and you search for stick yoga.
Okay.
Stick yoga, like a stick in the ground.
Okay.
And and you'll come up to the YouTube channel that has Dennis Dunphy doing different exercises. Yeah.
Good.
It's great. It's for everyone, truly, disabled or not. It is, if you want to work up to being more healthy.
Definitely.
It is a very good vehicle.
Oh, that's fantastic. Well, Emily, I want to thank you very much for joining us. Really appreciate it.
It's my pleasure. It's really fun.
And thank you so very much for joining us. Until next time, I'm Donna Yeager with On the Move. Have a wonderful day. Anyway, this is great. Lots of fun. Bye now. We all can choose to make a difference. Our time is overdue. If we collect our dreams, take them on the move. We're rolling and we're walking, but we're not sitting still. There's a world of adventure to explore. We're signing and we're talking from New York to Brazil, from Canada on out to Singapore. We're on the move to make this world a better place. We're on the move, we're striking out to set the pace.